Welcome to the 47th in a series of shows focused on Brookline as an age-friendly community. In 2012, the town of Brookline was the first community in New England to be designated an age-friendly city by the World Health Organization of the United Nations. This year, AARP also named Brookline as one of its age-friendly communities. This resulted from work throughout the years by the town departments, by the select board, by Brookline residents, and leadership provided by Brookline Can, an all-volunteer organization that works on issues in town for all ages. All viewers are welcome to join the Brookline Can network of people, ideas, and actions at brooklinecan.org website. Our guest today is Christina Metcalf in the newly created position of Brookline Communications Officer, a position we've all been looking forward to. Christina began her career in the libraries, fostering, as she said, a love for community engagement. For the past 5 years, she's focused on municipal communications, winning first place in the 2020 Massachusetts Municipal Association and Annual Report Contest. She was also completed the prestigious MMA Suffolk Certificate in Local Government Leadership and Management, demonstrating a commitment to excellence in public service. Prior to working in municipalities, she honed creative skills at a boutique design and photography company, experience which gives her a unique understanding of how visual communications can be used to effectively engage with the public. Welcome, Christina.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited to be here and talk with you about what we're doing in Town Hall for Communications.
Great. Could we first start with the position itself? Because this is a brand new position that I will tell you a number of the various committees and things were asking for, anybody related to the town communications. So it's really great to see you in that position. But, right. But tell us more about it.
Sure. So I know the position was posted in early January, and I know that there was a different sort of iteration of a community engagement position before I came here. But I, from what I understand it, I don't know if it didn't really work as intended, or it was just a different sort of position. And so Chaz and his infinite wisdom moved it into our into the town administrator select board office. And in doing my research for the position, seeing that, you know, that was something that he wanted, I think within that he had mentioned within his first few months of being here in Brookline and when he started back in 2022. And for me, municipal communications positions are on the rise. It's something that a lot of towns are realizing that they need somebody to have unified and cohesive communications efforts so that we're, you know, the town is one voice, one brand, one entity, and is communicating as such. And so there's a lot that goes into it in terms of the written communications, printed materials, social media, the website. And so we have a great team here that has a little bit, you know, does a little bit of everything. And my goal is to create a strategic communications plan and then have everybody who is doing their communications. If, you know, some departments are a little bit more staffed and have the availability to do a little bit more and focus on communications, and others don't have that availability. So working with them to really improve what other, you know, what departments are doing really well and help out the departments that maybe don't have the time and to focus on communications and really just grow what we're doing and make sure that we're getting the word out about really, you know, fun events that are coming up, important issues that, you know, concern town residents and stakeholders, and make sure that we're just educating, informing, alerting, and a little bit of entertainment as part of our communication. So that's really what I'm focused on.
Excellent. And that's a good description of all the issues and all the questions and all the things that we've needed in the past. Mm-hmm. I've been a member of a number of committees that were related to some of that, and it's great to see you there, because we did start. You're right; they started trying to go in that direction with some help, trying to unify some of the communications. But it was just at the bare beginnings and with no real formal feel to it at all. So nobody really knew what was happening. So now there's a feeling, you know what it is. Mm-hmm. That's great. Now this show relates to mostly older adults in the mm-hmm. community, and the communication needs are at least as great, mm-hmm. are similar to everybody, but the ways of getting them vary. Have you looked into some of the needs of older adults in communications?
Sure. So, yeah, there's a lot of different ways. And I think that you look at all the different audiences. And so in this case, talking about an older generation who maybe is coming up with the technology a little bit, maybe is not. And so making sure that while we're putting information on social media and on the website, that we're also doing printed materials, that we're also, going to the Council on Aging, or making sure that the Council on Aging, when they have events and people are coming into the senior center, that they are, we put flyers out and they're aware of information. And maybe it's putting information in the beacon so that people who are regular readers of that get that. Doing mailings with the census that goes out. I know that there's prime real estate and getting, certain, town information into that census mailing, because it is a big mailing and it reaches everybody. So really it's just taking a look at what works and what doesn't for this for the older adults. And sometimes, with where we are in evolution, I think that it's only getting better and better but I think that more older adults are getting more comfortable with technology or seeking out because they understand that that's the way to, connect if they have kids and grandkids that they're seeing information on Instagram or Facebook or, all the different social media sites and sharing photos that way and being involved in the community that way. So not only is it reaching them, but also giving them, giving you the opportunity to, if you want to learn more, giving those opportunities. I know there's a Tech Buddies program that is run out of the Council on Aging and Emergency Management Office. So that's, another great program that would just further, senior and older adult information getting. So really just meeting people where they're at in terms of how they receive information and constantly doing an audit of how people are receiving information so that we're always communicating in the best way for all the audiences that we want to reach.
Answering all my questions.
I'm sure you'll stump me.
No, it's really good. It's really good. But I'm going to throw in the visual communication question. I think that it already shows things like flyers, but where does that really come in? Because everything you said is true. Everything you said is true. There still will always be people that need either paper or access to a technology capability that may not be theirs. So for instance, going to the senior center and getting help as the tech buddies, et cetera. But you hit it all. I mean, you hit it all. But the visual really intrigues me because there are people who could really react to visual, your flyers. I mean, that's a good start. Well, right. Where does it apply? Yeah.
I think that, having the social media background and the design, a little bit of design background that I do have, you want to, people react to videos and photos and pictures and graphics more than they would text. So that's why, a platform like Instagram is so great for putting visual media out there. And Facebook as well, there's data that shows that Facebook posts that have visuals, whether it be a photo, whether it be a graphic, get more attention and are read more than just a plain text post on Facebook. Probably the same with Twitter or X. I don't have those numbers, but I know for Facebook for sure. So creating something that's grabbing the attention of the person, it's the attention span with social media has gone down. So you're getting people scrolling through and you want to make sure that you're designing something that's eye-catching that will grab their attention and make them want to read a little bit more or look at a little bit more about what you're doing. So, and really having a polished look and again, going through the communications and making sure that we're putting out visuals, whether it's photos or graphics that are eye-grabbing and catch the attention of the consumer that we're trying to reach.
Okay, I'm taking notes. I'm going to work on my Brookline Can Facebook page and the other. And you're right. Everything you described is exactly what happened. So that's great. You mentioned the survey. Mm-hmm. What is the National Community Survey?
So I came in on the end of that when I started back in February, but the National Community Survey, it is done through a company called Polco. And they do this, they do a survey all over the country. I believe that it's, I want to say from the data that I have, about 500 different communities. And what they do is they have a set of questions that they answer in terms of the community, public safety, livability, affordability, economic development, schooling, education, all these different facets, and ask the residents to rate them. And we also have the ability to ask a couple of core questions, so that are specific to the moment in time that we are doing the survey. And we do the survey about every 3 years. I know that we didn't do it back in 2021, probably because of the pandemic, but we did it back in 2018. And so this year we asked questions about the form of government in Brookline, and what people knew and how people felt about that, and if they wanted that, as I know that's a discussion that is coming around and being talked about now in Brookline.
Yes, absolutely. That was one of my points when you described the communications, being the largest town in Massachusetts, certainly. That's a town meeting, and this form of government, communication is even more important because it can be fragmented so easily. Mm-hmm. But that's all right. Yeah, thank you. Did you get any feel or any reaction to it? Did something come pop out?
Off the top of my head. We did. If you haven't seen the Select Board Summer Workshop, we discuss it, and I give a quick overview of the presentation. It's also available on the Select Board page under the National Community Survey. So if you want to read a little bit more about and the process and how Polco went through everything, and that we did a targeted survey, and they use their technology and try to get an even demographic of an even snapshot of all of Brookline, and then we also did an open survey, and they put all those results together. And so one of the things that I do remember is that the satisfaction with customer service of town hall staff increased, I think, by, I want to say, 8 to 10 points. So our staff is really, really great. And again, one of the reasons why I wanted to come to Brookline, because just of the stellar reputation and exciting things that you guys have going on. So I think that there's definitely, let me see off the top of my head. I think great feedback for the Select Board to take and then create goals from. And I know that they're doing another goal setting session in the fall, I want to say September or October. And so if you want to, again, look out for that, whether it's the recording or the live broadcasting of that is going to be available. And really looking to make sure that we're attending to what Brookline needs in the next year. Also, you know, long-term planning, but really wanting to make sure that we're taking that account into survey. We're taking all the past budget process to plan for the future budget and goals for Brookline.
Thank you. The events, I'd like to get to really what's happening and give you an opportunity to tell us and bring us up to date. What's happening in the summer and the fall?
Sure. So I'm going to share my screen, and I have a couple of visuals. And let me. So one of the most upcoming things we have is Saturday, July 27th, is the flock party. And this is going to be the unveiling of the turkeys that are completed for this round, that will be installed through the Brookline Art Makes Community Initiative. So we're going to have a flock party at the Coolidge Corner Courtyard Marriott. They have a public courtyard that they that is allowed for public spaces. So we're partnering with them. And from 10 to 12 that Saturday, we're going to have the unveiling at 11. We're going to have prizes and a raffle at the end of the around 11:45, and really just it's going to be a family friendly event. So we're going to have lawn games. We're going to have a DJ flock star is going to be there with some music. And it's just going to be a really great celebration of this initiative through the Economic Development Office and the Brookline Art Makes Community group. I've seen some of the turkeys, and they just they're in the process, and they're really cool. And at the end of this, I know we're going to have another party in November For the rest of the turkeys, and there are 10 total that are going to go up and around town. And if you haven't, Aaron Norris, who was the senior economic development planner who is leading this project, we had gone around and put lawn signs at the different locations. So if you see a lawn sign with this turkey, that means that a turkey is going to be installed there really soon. So it's really exciting. It's really great. And it really is just trying to get people to come to the community, see the art. We also have as part of the BAMC initiative, there's murals around town. There's other art around town. There's also the utility boxes that are painted that are really great. And if you follow the Instagram page for Brookline Planning, they do a featured artist Friday sometimes and has is featuring those artists and their work. So it's a really great initiative and just brings a lot more color and vibrancy to our great neighborhoods.
As long as that doesn't become the symbol of Brookline.
No.
I really
it's a hot topic, but it's a really fun. I know other communities have their different statues, and so this is just the turkey was what was decided by, I believe, by that, a steering committee, and so I think it'll be great and a lot of fun.
It's a great visual, by the way. So talk about visual. There's no way that doesn't catch your eye. Stop you dead.
Yeah.
No matter where it shows up.
Right. I know. I can't take credit for the turkey itself. That was done by Aaron Norris and his team. So they have some, again, one of the groups that have some good branding in place and recognizable. So when you see that turkey, that BAMC logo, that means that it's a project through
and a lot of flyers have nice pictures and don't have the date.
Mm-hmm.
And don't have the time. So you look at it and you say, oh, well, all right. Just scroll up. And this catches you completely, by the way.
Thank you. All right. And then our next, not something else. It's not an event per se, but something that we have just launched is our housing case inquiry portal. And so if you're a resident in Brookline who is having an issue, if you're issue with your rental, whether you're having a problem paying for it, you're having an issue with utilities that aren't being utilities that are being provided. So you're having issues with your heat, your hot water, electricity, things like that. If you have a pest control problem, if your trash isn't even getting picked up, you can go to this portal. You create an account and then you can select what your issue is. And we have a predetermined list of about 20 different issues that that potentially could arise. We're always adding to it. This is in its sort of infancy of what we're doing with it, and so we're always looking to make it better and get feedback to do that. It's not a guarantee that we're going to be able to help with everything, but we're really the goal is to make sure that we're connecting residents with as many resources that are available as possible that they may not know about, whether it's internally through different down departments or whether we can connect them with an external group or community group that can help them with their issue and whether it's funding or just problem, conflict resolution with any issue that they have with their housing. That's what we want to be able to do, is to facilitate that a little bit better and point them in the right direction for their housing needs.
Yeah, that's communications. Thank you. That's something that is not easily known. Extremely important. And I understand you're saying the cautions and everything else, but the ability to reach somebody mm-hmm. is a really good start. So yeah, that's great.
Right. And with the account, whatever you choose, it gets directed to the correct department to help you out. So yeah. It's not going into an email that maybe one person is reading or, it's not going to be lost. We have a process for getting a response. And even if it's just we received it and we're looking into what we can make better and connecting with them to make sure that, again, we can point them in the direction of resources or get them help directly, depending on what their issue is.
In my career, we used to call the alternative tombolia. Anyway, that's really great.
Recreation, they have their summer concert series. So they have about 4 concerts left. So I think the next one coming up would be the Mystic Jammers on the 24th, and then Kaliba, the Splinters, and Knock on Wood. They're at the Fisher Hill Reservoir Park, 6 to 7:30 every Thursday evening. And if you know, I know that we've had some storms and things like that. So if you follow the recreation page, they will let you know if there's any, you know, weather issue and whether they cancel or not. So again, following that social media and also on their website, I'm sure that they do that as well.
Well, the weather's great when we're recording this.
Yes.
I don't know when people see it, whether it'll be good. But...
Exactly, I know. And then August 6th is National Night Out for the police department. So police and fire, and we'll be at the Lynch Center at 599 Brookline Ave. And it's really just a great way for the police department to do some local outreach and show off what they're doing and really interact with the community. It's usually a really fun night. So if you're available and have the time to check it out on August 6th from 5 to 8, I know the police department would love to see you, anybody there.
Great. I like the
yeah. And then one of the last things is, and the I don't know if people know, but the Hemlock Grill, they were named the 2024 Best Fried Chicken Sandwich for Best of Boston. And I was lucky enough to be able to go to the Hemlock Grill recently and have that sandwich, and I can tell you it is phenomenal and fantastic. And I would encourage anybody looking for a good fried chicken sandwich or really just good food in general to go and check out the Hemlock Grill. And if you're a golfer, it's a perfect place to golf. And then at the Robert Lynch golf course, and then grab some food afterwards.
But it's open to the public. You don't have to be a golfer.
Nope. Right? Nope. The Hemlock Grill is open to anyone who wants to partake. It's just right. It's the same location as the Robert T. Lynch golf course. Mm-hmm. I know there's, you know, a whole bunch of other things going on. I'm going to stop sharing all I have prepared, but there's so many things going on. And again, we have the town administrator newsletter that comes out at the beginning of every month is available on the website. And we post it online. And I know that in speaking with Ruth Ann, we're going to do a test printing of maybe 25 to 50 of the town administrator newsletters to make sure that and putting them at the senior center and maybe the library as well, so that people who maybe don't aren't going online as much will be able to see it, and then maybe if they see it in print, they'll be able to, you know, want to see it online as well. So that's another testing that we're going on, and that administrator newsletter has you know, our town administrator Chas Carey, all, you know, he writes an introduction and just let you know what's going on with his office and everything in town, and then every department has a chance to put information on there. So it's really, I think the last one in August was, or July was the biggest one yet at 30 pages. So chock full of really great things and information about what's going on in town in the upcoming months.
Yeah, that's really great. That's answers some of the, I realize it's just an experiment, this thought, but really good one.
Yeah.
Yeah. So you're probably answering my other question, which is the best way for people to communicate with you. I also was going to ask you the various outlets, but I think you mentioned them all that already that I can think of, unless the, oh, Brookline.news mm-hmm. is very good. Do you post there? That was one that I had a question about. And the Boston Globe, how does our town has a funny relationship with the Globe?
So, right. So Brookline.news, yes, I actually recently was in contact with Sam Mintz, and he and I now have access to be able to post events and different things. And he is a great partner to get information out about what's going on around town and covering the issues in an unbiased way. And also with the Globe, we have different relationships with the Globe and different reporters and news stations. So we have a consulting firm, JGPR, who are partner with them. And so, you know, when we put out press releases and information about things going on around town, they're connected to them and us. And if there's an inquiry, I don't think that we haven't looked into what we do and don't post in the Globe, but I think that making sure that, you know, we want to make sure that we're involved in and understanding what's going on in the cities and towns around us, and that what impacts Brookline, but also making sure that we're telling Brookline's story locally. And so if that's like something like the, you know, the best of Boston with the fried chicken sandwich, that's definitely, you know, great thing to share. And it's coming out of Boston and I'm sure in the Globe or whatever publication that came out of. But I don't think it's something to not look into. I just think it's, we're focusing, I think, really on making sure that we're getting people with our social media, with the website, with the newsletter, and then doing that really well. And then when we have the opportunity to expand, to do that, and maybe it's
I don't. Globe appears to ignore Brookline, but I think it's in most cases, unless it's a bad story, of course, that'll come out. But other than that, they usually do. When they talk about west of Boston, it starts at Brookline. And otherwise it's Boston. So they tend to ignore good things, or just things happening, which is fine. I mean, it's just wondering whether there's any, you know, that's great. That describes it well.
And as well as, you know, different social media and the website, on the town administrator page, there is a communications page. So it has my information, but also the different, right now we're in the middle of a branding project and survey. And I think that by the time this airs, the survey would be closed, but there will be an opportunity for residents and stakeholders in the town to we're going to go over the survey results, make sure that we're going in the right direction. And for a little bit of a new look for Brookline, we're still going to be using the town seal on, you know, different official documents, but really moving towards sort of a fresh, modern look for Brookline to update that. I know a lot of other cities and towns are looking at doing that. The Mass Municipal Association just put out a webinar on the rebranding of a town, and the focus was Amesbury, who redid their brand in 2022, and it's really interesting the way they went about it, and they had public input, but it was also under the town administrator's office to really make those decisions and be able to fine-tune the process and make sure that we're getting the public input, but we're also, you know, we know we're not going to make everybody happy with what the new brand.
There's bound to be, no matter what the choice is, there's bound to be a vocal.
And we understand that. And I think that you're going to find that. And even with Amesbury, I know, Natick redid theirs as well, I think in 2022 or 2023, and Needham is in the process of redoing theirs and had just sent out an email of, you know, I think they're in the final rounds of getting public input on a final design that they have and color scheme. So it really is a, you know, to not have it be a year or 2 year long process, really making sure that we're getting input at the beginning, we're getting input at the end, and in the middle, we're making it streamlined so that we can get everything. And we have a great team in place to make sure that that's happening. We have our select board liaison is David Perlman, and he's been great on the board and helping us and making sure that we're following and listening to the public, as well as we all in the town administrator's office want to make sure that we're doing that as well. So it's a really balanced and well thought out process that we're doing, and we hope to have a logo or two to choose from or comment on at Brookline Day on September 8th.
Oh, interesting. Oh, great. And when does the survey end? And when did it end?
I think that the survey ended on July 19th. And so it's been out there. We would have sent it out. And then the final results will be put together, and we'll have that hopefully community input session at the end of July or beginning of August to make sure, again, like that all the feedback and information that we got from the survey is going in the right direction. So if, you know, one of the questions was, you know, what colors do you think of when you think of Brookline? And so if we're getting, oh, we think it's green and orange, and that's completely off base. I'm not saying that it is green and orange. But if we have that, you know, if that's completely off base and we get input that's, you know, those aren't our colors, it's, you know, these different colors, then we want to make sure that we're hearing that. Because sometimes people, you know, if they miss the survey or just, again, want to have a a little bit more input in person. That's always helpful. And again, feedback can only help us refine and make that this process better and the end product better.
Great. I'm looking forward to seeing the results of that. We're actually coming to the end. I want to thank you. We could go on and on. Anytime you want to come back, anytime you want to come back or you want to send us somebody that you think is important to communicate with, please do that. And keep up the communications with us, because that will help both us and you, I think.
Absolutely. And again,
thank you.
Thank you for having me. It was really great to be here and chat with you.
And as far as the audience is concerned, that they should be aware that we rebroadcast the show over the next very few weeks, as usual with all shows. All the programs are available on Brookline Can website and on the Brookline Can Facebook and Twitter or X accounts. Nobody calls it X. Twitter accounts. Thank you and take care and be safe.
Thank you so much. Have a great one. Bye.